Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining. This is William Steele, True Crime King. And on my first week of my new podcast, we're doing True Crime here. We're going to be interviewing a whole bunch of people from a variety of backgrounds. Everybody from everybody who has a story to tell, organized crime figures who've changed their life, written books, making movies, celebrities, some of the mentors in my life, attorneys, and various other well-known people. And we're also going to be profiling cases of unsolved homicides with some crime victims out here that are looking for answers to their murdered loved ones, what really happened. For example, we have a lady in Long Island whose daughter was evidently murdered, and they're ruling it a suicide. She wants us to take a look at that and try to see if we can get her some answers, and also missing persons person cases. So as you guys know, I like you I appreciate all your support of my new TV show on A&E, Inmate to Roommate. It's in the Nielsen ratings now. It's blowing up in the ratings. It's the fifth most popular TV show in the country right now. And this has all happened in the last few weeks. So I'm just grateful to be here, and I'm grateful for my guest tonight. So tonight, who we have with us is Anthony Salvatore Luciano Raimondi. He was an enforcer with the Colombo crime family, and he is an eloquent Brooklyn speaker like myself. He's from my he's from my hometown, so we know how to get each other. We get each other's sense of humor and sarcasm and stuff, and so we all know the same spots in Brooklyn. You know, we won't talk about too much about my background. Everybody knows, you know, I was a pretty prolific jewel and art thief and running guns to Brooklyn and cocaine and all that. And so Anthony ran in different circles than me. I tried to avoid guys like Anthony because, you know, they just, they were doing their own thing in their own world, and they had the way they did things. And I was very much a loner. So, but anyway, so our worlds collide now in our new lives, trying to do the right thing and trying to use our stories to help people. And so with that, I'd like to introduce Anthony. Anthony, thank you so much for joining me tonight. And
pleasure, William.
If you could add a little something to your backstory, tell us who Anthony Raimondi is, who he actually was. Actually, tell us about how you grew up, your past, you know, if you could sum it up, and then I'll go with some questions from there.
My grandfather, Antonio Raimondi, my father's father, his cousin, his real last name was Luciano, but they call it Luciano, but I'll explain everything. Lucky Luciano, or Lucena, was our real last name, but it was changed to Luciano when Lucky came here from Italy. They changed it up at Ellis Island. My grandfather, Antonio, that was his cousin by blood. Now, great-grandpa Antonio Lucena, which was Lucky's father, he had an affair with a woman, and he had four daughters. There was Auntie Cumbelina, Auntie Mary, Auntie Lucy, and Aunt Nancy. Nancy was my grandmother. She was Lucky's half-sister. My grandfather, like I said, who was cousins to Lucky, blood cousins, first cousins, fell in love with my grandmother, who would be like, I guess you'd say, his half-cousin. And basically, he kidnapped her and married her. Now, Lucky became not only his cousin, but it's his brother-in-law. And then, the rest of the family, they got married. Like Aunt Lucy married Uncle Ralph Guido, who was a big man in the black hand. Now, my grandfather, Antonio Raimondi, he had a kid cousin named Carmine Galenti, which I'm sure you know the name of Carmine Galenti. These were his relatives from Italy. They were all related. Now, on my mother's side, there was my grandfather, who used to use, who had the last name Costello. Legitimately, his name was Costello. And Frank Costello was his cousin. And his, his last name was, the real last name was, I forgot the real last name of Uncle Frank's. But what happened, when he took the name Costello, it's on the tip of my tongue, I can't remember. Castiglia. His real name was Castiglia. But when he came to the United States, he took the name Costello. Now, when they would come to look for Uncle Frank, as I called him, he was my grandfather's cousin. I called him Uncle because you got to remember, these guys are like 40 years older than me at least. They would come to my grandfather. Now, my grandfather was only 5'4". Okay? Frank Costello was 6'2". So what my grandfather did, he changed his name to Castle because we had cousins with the name Castle in the old country. And Uncle Frank was still using the name Costello. Now, also on my grandfather's side, my grandfather Casa, his mother's side was Anil Della Croce. That was her cousin who became my grandfather's cousin when he married my grandmother. Now, my grandfather, Frank Casa, I will call it Frank Casa, he bought a house on Baltic Street in Brooklyn between 3rd and 4th Avenue. It was an 8-family house. There was only family living in it. All my aunts, all my uncles, no strangers, strictly family. And we were on the second floor, and my grandfather and grandmother were next to us. Then there was my Uncle Frank, my Uncle Jack, my Uncle Tom, my Uncle Santo, my other Uncle Frank. They were all in the whole house. Now, on Baltic Street, it was a one-way going up the block, like from 3rd Avenue to 4th Avenue. And I remember when I was a kid, I see all these guys coming to the house. And I was told who they were. And they said they used to call them uncle because, like I said, I was a kid. These guys were already, I'd say, probably in their 30s at the time, maybe even a little older. I called them all uncle out of respect because they were all older than me. But they were cousins. And I used to see these guys, huge cars, pockets full of money. I mean, every time I would come in the house, they would all call me over. I would talk with them. They would turn around, say something to me. And if I answered them like cursed at one of them, they would hand me a $20 bill. They would hand me a $20 bill. So I saw money. As I'm getting older, now I'm seeing what's going on. And I'm thinking, these guys are doing something good. Now, my father had three other brothers. There was my Uncle Joe, who was a Shylock. My Uncle Nino, who handled all the swag and everything down at the PS7 in Brooklyn. And my Uncle Sal, who was my godfather. My Uncle Sal, he handled it. He had his big thing was Shylock and swag, bookmaking. I mean, if you wanted a Sherman tank, he could get it for you. Now, as far as I knew, my father worked down the piers. That's all I knew. He went to work. How can I put it? Never saw him or heard of him being involved in anything. Now, with that, I met Uncle Lucky. Now, Uncle Lucky got deported, which is true. He did get deported. But when I tell everybody, he always came to the United States about maybe 5 years after he got deported, at least 4 times a year. And the government knew he came in.
Let me ask you a question, Anthony. Yeah. For the uninformed, just sum up real quickly who Lucky Luciano was. For my audience, who is not necessarily all organized crime-based, may not know the name, although I know the name.
All right. My Uncle Lucky Luciano had his own family, which now they call it the Genovese family, but that was my Uncle Lucky's family. And my Uncle Lucky is the one who put together the National Commission and the New York Commission. The New York Commission is made up of the 5 families in New York. The National Commission is made up of all the families around the country that are in organized crime. Now, Uncle Lucky used to come, like I said, 3-4 times a year. The government knew he came there. They never bothered him because during the war, he got Italy and especially Sicily to help them against the Germans with the submarines and the piers. And even in Brooklyn, he got all the dock workers. So the government used to turn their blind eye, as they say, which they've done that with quite a few things.
Weren't there German agents smuggling in like explosives and stuff into New York? And the Italian mob, Lucky Luciano, helped eradicate that and run them out?
Yeah, because he took over. He had the piers. He had all the piers, the Brooklyn piers, Manhattan piers. He was controlling Jersey piers with the old man, Rayo, out there. They were controlling all the piers all around, but everything was under his orders. Now, he used to bring around a friend of his named Maya Lansky, which Maya, for some reason, don't ask me why, how, where, he just took a liking to me from the time I was a kid. And every time that they would come in, everybody would always come to my grandfather's house on Baltic Street. And my mother would do all the cooking. They loved the way my mother cooked. But you see, I've seen Carl Gambino was there. I mean, Tommy Rayner would come down there. All these guys, from the Lucchese family, Tommy Lucchese. All these guys came down. Joe Bonanno was like a friggin' fixture. He was so close with my father and my Uncle Sal. He was like a freaking fixture over there. Tom DiBella was down there. Tom O'Long was down there. Tommy Martino. All the guys would come down there. All the guys from all the families that would come down.
What time frame are we talking about now? Because a lot of the younger guys, like, they don't know you and they don't know who you are, who you rolled with. And so there's been some controversy back and forth, which we won't get into here at all. But I'm just curious what time frame, because you're with these old timers who were even older than you at that time.
Yeah, because I was born in 1953. So we're talking like 1957, 58, 59, and so on up in the years.
Gotcha.
And these guys always came to the house because, like I said, my grandfather had the house on Baltic Street. It was an eight-family house. Either they would go into my grandfather's yard, because we had a yard that you had to go through the building, down the cellar, and then there was a door that went into the yard, and he had this big fence around it. And they would sit there and talk, or they would talk upstairs in the apartments. If they went upstairs in the apartment, whether it was mine or my grandfather's, my mother would go next door to her mother's apartment, or my grandmother would go to my mother's apartment, which was right next door to us. They talked about whatever, and then they would come downstairs and hang out, and they would have the cars double and triple parked, and the cops never bothered them. But they always came there. They always came. That was like, I guess you would call it like a safe haven, because my grandfather owned the house. All the family that lived in the house was all involved in the mob, all my uncles. So there wasn't any chance of like a stranger walking in or whatever. That's how come they used to come all over, they used to come all the time over there, and they used to talk.
Is that house still standing today?
No. What happened, 1960, I think it was 66 or 67, the city came in and bought up the houses. They bought them all up, and they were making what they call the projects over there. So my father bought a house on 12th Street in Brooklyn between 3rd and 4th Avenue, which now they call it Park Slope. It was called South Brooklyn, but it was always Park. It was Park Slope now, but to me, it was always South Brooklyn.
Right.
And he had a private house there. And right next door, he got the house from my Uncle Tom, which was my mother's brother. And they used to come to the house on 12th Street. Of course, my grandfather, Frank, came with us on 12th Street. Now, my grandmother had already passed away, my grandfather's wife. But my grandfather, Antonio, used to come down there also. Now, Antonio, my grandfather Antonio, my father's father, on Columbia Street, he owned a piece of a bakery called Chofi's Bakery, and he had the apartment upstairs above it. And across the street, he had a barber shop. They used to call him Tony the Barber. But the funny thing that I found out, like I said, later on, as the years went by, guys would come there that were supposedly getting a haircut, but meanwhile, they were already in the back room talking, or they go up to the apartment. And I found out that a couple of times guys would go in there and nobody saw them anymore.
Right.
You know, my both grandfathers were involved in the Black Hand from Sicily. Both of them. Both of my grandfathers, which when I send you the book, I'll get the pictures out and everything. I'll show you everything. Both of my grandfathers were no taller. One was 5'4", one was 5'6". Their wives were both taller than the both of them. Their wives were taller than them, truthfully. But these are my grandfathers. And I remember one year, I was about 9 years old. I grew on Baltic Street. And I used to tell my grandfather, he was there, Uncle Lucky was there, Maya, they were all there. And I said, I want to be like you guys. So he says, what do you mean you want to be like us? I said, I want to be a wise guy like you guys. My grandfather turned around and says, listen to me. He says, we're not wise guys. He says, we're not friends. We're not none of this. I says, what do you mean? He goes, we are gangsters. Look at us. What do you mean, gangsters? Because we are gangsters. We take care of our own. We do what we want to do. We take care of our own. We don't go run to anybody to ask permission. We do what we got to do. We are gangsters. And I remember Uncle Lucky told me that too, and Maya told me the same thing. They all told me that. Says we're not wise guys. We're not. They said they see everybody throws that word mafia around and Cosa Nostra. I think everybody throws it around because it's like a. It's like a popular thing to do. You know what I'm saying? Everybody's always throwing it around. You go on the internet, either they're talking mafia, Cosa Nostra. That's all they talk about. They don't know. You know, people are using that as they hear everybody else saying it. But my grandfather said, we are gangsters. I'll never forget when he told me that.